Classic Rock Beagle.
Welcome to the Annals of the Classic Rock Beagle. We review music and topics from the classic rock era, and I'm Dobbs, and this is the star of the show, Moser the Classic Rock Beagle, who expresses displeasure right out of the gate. What's wrong, Moser? Mm-hmm. Yeah, until recently, you're right. I doubt that. Worse than that?
He's more of a beagle. Not the dumbest breed of dog, but pretty dumb.
Ooh, that's pretty egregious. Tell you what, Moser, do what you need to do after the show. Today, we're celebrating a milestone on the show. Yes, we've hit triple digits in subscribers. That's right, Moser. You remember the announcement? When we hit 100 subscribers, we'll rank Billboard's year-end number one songs during the classic rock era inclusive from 1965 to 2000. Same thing when we hit 200 subscribers, we'll rank the year-end number two songs, and so forth until we rank the year-end number 100s at 10,000 subscribers.
Son, you're on your own.
So today we'll rank all the year-end number one songs during the classic rock era, as we promised. Because the young ones actually played a major part of us hitting that, we'll extend the date range to 2022. So to rank the number one songs on Billboard's year-end Hot 100, I'll go back to 1963, make it 60 years. 1963 through 2022. Moser, we started an international incident last time we mentioned the number one song in 1962. You remember? And this was the biggest hit song of 1962 by Acker Bilk. Acker Bilk. His name sounds like calling somebody an ethnic slur in his own language. Really, Moser? This is a celebratory episode, and you pull out a recurring gag? Right, and backed by the Eagles. Ah! You had to go to the recurring gag group. Hello. Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you again. Anyways, as promised, since we are now in the triple digits subscribers, we review the top song from Billboard's Year End Hot 100 from 1963 through 2022 with the five elements of music in three bite-sized episodes. For those 6 years, 1963 to 2022, we reviewed each year-end number one song and are presented in separate videos spotlighting the great, the okay, and the bad. Today we'll review the crap. At number 60, crap.
Well, that was a piece of crap if I ever heard.
Oh, come on!
The background category will be different for these lists as opposed to our best of the decade or pop song of the year. Here we'll discuss my experience with the respective songs. When I first heard this song, my initial reaction was, phew, no one's ever gonna buy this. We can finally cast Bryan Adams to the... What do you mean it's number one? And with this success, I officially became a jaded Gen Xer. Bring on Nirvana. A lot of songs I don't like have elements in them that I wish I had written. A lot of care was put into the melody of this song. Honestly, I would have either discarded the melody or rewritten around the salvageable parts. And of course, this melody is sung by Brian Adams, who only records after gargling sand for about 20 minutes. At least he's in tune, but for the most part. Harmonically, it is a well-structured song. Shifting the bridge to B makes the subdominant for most of the song, an underutilized one at that, the dominant of the bridge. Also, the minor 4, the F sharp minor, introduces the coda. Theoretically, rhythm is not only about the danceability of a song. Still, there's nothing to this dirge. Well, that lame-ass coda does add a little variety. The tone is not offensive to the ears, except for Adams' voice. Nothing good either, though. Congratulations to the fourth grader who wrote those lyrics. They are generic fluff lyrics, to be sure, but a fine achievement for someone writing his first song. Hold on. Moser informs me that lyrics are written by Adams himself. A 31-year-old man who has paid his bills by writing and recording songs for 8 years by this point. Hack.
At the start, I knew there were only going to be two songs that could ever suck enough to earn this spot. And congrats to the hack from the Great White North, whose lazily written love song stands at number 60, with 1.68 out of 10, a low, brutal song. At number 59, the other song with the extraordinary level of suck.
I wasn't paying much attention to music in 1999, but it's not as if America would make a major hit by auto-tuning to death a has-been on a glorified Eurobeat song or something. What's next? A Santana comeback? No matter how hard I try, how do you get worse than Brian Adams? I've made my distaste for Cher's voice patently clear in past episodes. Then you add the rough auto-tune to it. Although it leaves an F for the melody, it is an effective science experiment. It shows just how to auto-tune an unnatural Cher sings with her natural voice. And the chord structure has an unremarkable 1-3-4-5 progression in the verse. The chorus skirts around the pop chords, which wasn't really an issue in the 90s yet, so I'll give it a pass. I can feel something inside to say. I really don't think you're strong enough. The rhythm's okay, it's nothing special. It's Eurobeat by numbers. It's AB. A, B, C, B, B. This is so textbook. No curveballs at all. I would give you my opinion, but I'm distracted because I poured Drano into my ears to dull the pain after hearing this song a few times. The only thing that's keeping the timbre from an F is an effective guitar counter melody in the chorus. Imagine that. combo bragging breakup song. The lyrics aren't normally supposed to be the best part of a Eurobeat song. Not that this is a towering achievement in poetry.
Cher's crap is more acerbic than Bryan Adams' bore, but at least the production was better. Give Believe 1.79 out of 10 a brutal song. At number 58, the song that I've savaged on the show in episode 1. So it's confirmed, running face first into a brick wall hurts less than the sound of Rod Stewart's voice.
Well, the melodic line here is not bad. But then again, Rod Stewart actually has a worse voice than Bryan Adams. As I said in my savage review of the song in episode 1, there are musical elements that work, including the chord structures. I'm not counting the beats per minute from the intro, because that's flexible tempo. This 240 beats per minute, 6/8, actually sounds like 80 beats per minute. There's nothing special about the rhythm. It doesn't add nor subtract from the song, so we'll give it a C. Not an extraordinary form, but the sax solo playing in a different key was a nice touch. You know what? The musical tracks actually sound nice. We'll get into why this song is third from the bottom of the list when we get to the lyrics section. The lyrics section. I defer to what I said about the lyrics in episode 1. Dobbs?
And then you have the sultry screech, heralding a rape anthem of a generation. Don't believe me? Child rape. Gross, gross, gross. Even Robin Thicke would say, dude, that's sick. In my conclusion to the review in episode 1, I said there are things that work in the music. The Rod voice and his message poison the song for me. In our first episode, I gave it 2.5 out of 10. In 2020, it improved to 3.28 out of 10, but it still ranks in the same bad category. At number 57, an artist I want to like, but just can't.
I really wanted to be nice to her. She was Karen Carpenter's best friend.
What? So anyways,
I hated this song so much in 1982. I still hate it, but I have different reasons now. We'll discuss that mostly in the melody section. Finally, decent singer. Too bad her voice is all wrong for the song. The mortal sin of the song was her lightweight voice did not match the tenor of what the song was going for. In short, they got the wrong singer for the song. Look, Olivia is quite pretty, but not sexy. Do you feel it when she sings Let's Get Animal?
Animal? I'm over here.
Hi!
Hi, Animal.
Hi!
No, there's nothing to the chords. The chords in the chorus extend to 4 measures for each core. This song is basic to the core. I've got to say, the rhythm's actually pretty good. I dare say the instrumental tracks are solid. More on that later. The solos are nice. Steve Lukather for the win. And again, the backing tracks can go with a good song. The musical tracks themselves are, what's the right word?
Very possible. Not bad at all.
Yeah, that. If the backing tracks went to a better song, this would be fine, but it also probably wouldn't have been as big a hit either. Now take those instrumental tracks and have sweet Olivia Newton-John sing outrageously raunchy lyrics over them. Yeah. Up next, Donny Osmond sings Hop for Teacher.
Maybe if someone like Donna Summer or Debbie Harry did it, it might have worked. Maybe. But this, I give 3.35 out of 10. This is a bad song. Olivia singing Let's Get Animal might be the most embarrassing lyric of the decade. Now hold on, hair metal, I take that back. Speaking of hair metal, at number 56.
Yeah, the poster child of a great band that completely went down the crapper is... Yeah, it's U2. But also Chicago. A decade or so into their suck phase, they released their biggest hit. And possibly their worst. Damn it, 80s! Okay. Bill Champlin has a good voice. And his voice fits the song. It's just that the song itself is so lame. It's a paint-by-numbers hair metal ballad by Chicago. It's the devolution from this to this. And I know for certain it's not the love. Okay, the website that I got these keys from came with this message. Okay, dude, I'm going to use your chords despite this statement, which automatically discredits all of your musical opinions. With the chords, there's nothing remarkable except doo-wop chords in the verse. That's not good. Typical hair metal formula. The beat is all jaw and no law. It's loud with gated reverb without adding any energy. This form was mercilessly beaten to death at the time that this garbage was released in 1989, replete with a key change. Chicago, where are the horns? Your crap machine didn't even give your best asset a token appearance. That leaves arrangement by rote hair metal, and not only that, hair metal light, the worst of all possible worlds. Okay. The lyrical theme of Pretend I'm Doing Fine Without You had been a bit played by 1989. Hell, played by 1959. But the lyrics aren't that bad.
Hair metal only makes one appearance on these 60 songs, and it was from a band that was once great. Hell Beginnings was honorable mention in my greatest songs of all time. That's embarrassing, guys. I look away from that grade. I give it 3.5 out of 10, the exact lowest spot in our lame category. How fitting. At number 55. Yeah, numbers are hard. Schmaltz from Burt Bacharach. A decade and a half after his relevance ended, as well as that about every one of the singers.
In 1986, four old-time artists, still somewhat known to us teenagers, got together and released a song we were convinced no one younger than 40 liked at the time. I heard the song a gazillion times as a teenager. It was in high rotation on MTV back in the day. I've got to say, the performances were pretty good. Material was meh. It's Burt Bacharach, so you're not getting much. But the talent among three quarters of the singers elevated his mediocrity. And the least talented singer, Dionne Warwick, was used for the first verse and chorus as well as the finish. That's a great call. Burt Bacharach comes with a little bit of sophistication and nuance in his chord structures. It takes a lot of talent to do that. It's still schmaltz, B minus. Sixty beats per minute, one beat a second. Snore. No gravitas in the song to justify the ultra slow tempo. Not much to the form, but they did a good job juggling the singers. Stevie's harmonica is literally the only thing that's keeping this category from being a D. It's 1985. Dionne Warwick's relevance is dead. She reaches out to her friend and longtime collaborator Burt Bacharach for help. He dusts off an old tribute to friendship previously given to Rod Stewart, and they decided to get big names to help out. None of whom were particularly friends, other than Stevie Wonder and Gladys Knight. Not only does this make the lyrics lightweight schmaltz, but it makes Dionne, what's the word?
Poser.
Yeah, that.
I want to thank Dionne and her fake friends for their assistance and service to humanity trying to rid the world of insomnia. But honestly, Burt Bacharach and Dionne Warwick have gone above and beyond in this field for decades at this point. This Snorefest finished at 3.78 out of 10, a lame song. Up next, maybe not the last rock song to top the year-end charts, but it is the last unambiguously rock song. Never made it as a wise man. I couldn't
cut it as a poor man stealing. Tired of living like a blind man. Before there was AI calculating commercially acceptable music, it was Nickelback. Melody. Nickelback.
I want some more.
More, huh? How about this? This is Nickelback to me. Chad Kroeger goes into the studio to lay down a vocal track to Creed for karaoke. And then he forgets how the song goes. Tell me that the vocal line here goes with the chords that are being played. It sure doesn't sound like that to me. Okay, four chord song. Cut them some slack.
Denied! Sit down!
Right then, D plus to the hacks from Nicholson. I honestly don't know what to give the rhythm here. It doesn't sound bad, but it doesn't really add any energy to it. That sounds like a C, doesn't it? He started writing about an intro. He ended the chorus on an unusual major chord. They changed the feel completely on the third verse. They tried. Lord knows Nickelback tried. Just nothing they did worked. Welcome to a world dominated by nu metal. And of course you're going to get the lightweight poser version of AWD as the number one song of the year. Again, 2002. More vague declarations of mixed emotions and angst. Got it. Not impressed. Oh, and Chad, please insert one of these. You apparently didn't use it for this song. Anything I can do to help.
Nickelback may not be the worst offender in lame AWB emotionalism devoid of real emotion. Ahem. Oh, okay. I mean, ahem. Picture Fred Durst. That also means they're not a good band. This is how they remind me that their biggest hit is lame. 3.83 out of 10. At number 53, one of the most popular songs of all time.
If I should stay.
Let me take you back there. It was January 1991. Operation Desert Shield was about to become the first war in my memory. My Bills were in the first Super Bowl in their history, and overwhelming favorites. Amid this unique, emotionally charged scenario, we get probably the greatest version of the Star Spangled Banner ever done at a sporting event. It still sends chills down my spine. About a year later, she released a soundtrack to her movie, The Bodyguard. Here is what I thought of her opening single.
I hated the song the first time I heard it. I hated it the thousandth time I heard it. I hated hearing it for this episode.
There is nothing wrong with Whitney's voice. Her performance is explosive and dynamic. Maybe not as emotionally charged as on other songs, but her instrument is spectacular here as usual.
That is all I'm taking with me.
There's the key change at the end. The lack of imagination regarding the chords to me is the mortal sin of the song. There are doo-wop chords throughout when you break them down, and it doesn't work. Recurring review of this episode so far. The rhythm of the song doesn't really add anything. It sounded like a savage takedown of the form in my review in episode 14. While it was a paint-by-numbers arrangement, the use of the strings at the end was really good. And Whitney and the drums did build steadily throughout the song. I thought at the time the sound was predictable and soulless. Upon further review, I'll back off that statement slightly. The sound is actually a strength-ish.
And I hope you have all you dreamed of.
There's actually a little real emotion in the lyrics, even if they're a bit basic.
In episode 12, I actually put the song in the bad category. After a few listens, I found some positives about the song. But it's still mostly Whitney's voice. It is upgraded to a mid-lame song, 3.95 out of 10. At number 52, we'll go from a song I'll Catch Hell for putting down to one that won't get that many people upset.
When the song was out, I was fairly positive about it and about Captain Tennille. Keep in mind, I was 6 years old. This was mostly because my mom really liked them. My views on them have changed drastically by the time my age was double digits. For those of you who are inclined to like the song, let me ruin the experience of it for you forever.
You gotta be strong.
Stop.
But I really love you.
Stop.
I'll be thinking of you. Look in my heart and let love.
It's not a bad melody. It's not a bad performance. Tennille, stop smiling. Ugh. Anyways, Tony Tennille at the time was an in-demand session singer. And the song was so obviously Sadaka, who wasn't. Moving on, Tony's unnatural smiley smile is giving me the creeps. Not bad. Like Bacharach, Sadaka was a sophisticated songwriter. The difference is that Sadaka knows a catchy melody when he hears one.
Oh, snap!
There are a lot of faults to the song. The rhythm's not one of the major ones. It's okay. This is not an ill-formed song. I've said it before, the Captain and Tennille are actually quite talented musicians. They just have terrible taste in music. It sounds pretty good. Again, they're talented musicians. Neil Sedaka, handy with the melody, clever with the harmony. Not even remotely compelling as a lyricist. And this song is lame even for Neil. One uptick for singing Sadaka is back in the na-nas in the end. That was nicely done.
Love Will Keep Us Together is exact opposite of the old whole is greater than the sum of the parts. With the grades in the review, only the lyrics are below average and not by much. But the song as a whole is a lame listen, 4.08 out of 10. At number 51, the song that turned out to be an obvious pose.
Wake up in the morning feeling like P. Diddy.
Hey, what up, girl?
Grab my glasses, I'm out the door, I'm gonna hit this city.
Let's
before
go.
I leave, brush my teeth with a bottle of gin.
After nearly acing her SATs, Kesha Seabird was an underground singer-songwriter until she appeared on the Flo Rida track Right Round in early 2009. Then came her debut solo single, TikTok. One of the better parts of the song is the melody and the chorus. Any merits it has is undone by the fake trashy verses. I wouldn't say they're done in rap, they're more of a stammer. Kesha won't spend any time on the chords, neither will I. For all the limitations of late club music, at times rhythm was okay. Here's the best part of the song. Yeah, all the effects are not a substitute for formal variation. The form is as formulaic as cheesy hair metal. Okay, and it's a personal preference here. I hate the pre-Lord musical world. The sound here does not work for me. It's not danceable, it's not energetic, doesn't elicit any real emotion, and to me it's not fun. Kesha herself is kind of fun on this song, but she turned out to be a major poser. Oh yeah, Kesha knew what she was doing. And as we now know, this is a drunken wreck pose. But damn, she sold it. Minimal credit where minimal credit is due.
You know, Kay, I'm glad you're out from under Doc Loop's thumb, because you're better than this. Your biggest hit, though, is infinitely better than your next hit. But it's still lame. 4.13 out of 10. At number 50, the number one song from the previous year.
Club music ruled the odds. Only in this world can such an unremarkable song as this one become number one song of the year. Now for the five elements of hip hop. There are four members of Black Eyed Peas and not one of them is on their game. Their flow is the same as or derived from the hook, which is consistent if nothing else. Yeah, that hook is nothing burger. Although there's a certain catchiness to it. For all the attention that was clearly put into the production of the song, that's the best sound you can get for the drums? And the beat itself also copies the one riff of the song. Will.i.am's production is basically your little brother. Genetically designed for the maximum piss-off, and there's not a damn thing you can do about it. The more irritating they sounded, the more successful they became. Despite my distaste for the song was actually crafted well in how the pieces are put together and through the ebbs and flows. Yeah, the words are all garbage and fluff. We know what lyric you're looking for comment upon, and the classic rock Beagle is here to serve. It went like this. Hey guys, listen up. This came with a great lyric. You know how 2008's coming soon? Yeah. So listen up. Let's go, we're so 2008, you're so 2000 late. That is hilarious. Brilliant, Will. I know, right? Good thing this is December 2007 as they came up with this hilarious lyric. Okay, let's lay down the track. Now I'll just tweak the production just a bit and done. Okay, it's ready. What month is it? February 2009. Okay. I guess that line won't work anymore. Well, I think, shut up, Taboo. You're basically our bass player. You will speak when spoken to. Yes, sir. Okay, Fergie, just say we're 3008. How much am I getting paid? More than the rest of us combined. 3008 it is. Wait, we're supposed to get paid? Taboo. I think there's a bit of dust on my Lamborghini. Will you go and take care of that? Yes, sir.
The Black Eyed Peas have had some good songs. Reference I Got a Feeling. They've also had some of the worst songs of all time. Reference My Humps. Boom Boom Pow is neither. I give it 4.43 out of 10. A very high-end, lame song. Up next, we go from the post-classic rock era to the pre-classic rock era.
Uno, dos, one, two, tres, cuatro.
Hey! Willy Bully was Sam the Sham's first single. seriously, Egyptian band name, he's wearing a Sikh turban, and the band has Saudi headdress. Cultural appropriation of a wide geographical area. You guys forgot the Persians. Hey, it's the 60s. I guess it's okay then. Here's a bit of trivia. Sam is called Sam the Sham because he knew he wasn't a good singer. Why, yes, Virginia, he's not. The melody is nothing special, but there's a legitimately fun vibe to it. Give it minimal credit. This is a strict blues progression, which is the basis of rock and roll. It's fine, but too basic to be the number one song of 1965. For all the faults of this song, all the many faults of this song, it is a really fun song. Okay, the form is as basic as you can get. The recurring riff adds just a touch more, so C+. The song is fun, but the playing leaves so much to be desired. Woolly Bully should have come out in 1962 when novelty songs were the rage.
The musician in me looks at Woolly Bully and goes, "Guys, it's 1965. We're already doing folk rock. Why is this the number one song of the year?" But it is fun, if not great. Overall, I give it 4.58 out of 10, just scraping into the mediocre category. At number 48, get ready to roll your hips and roll your eyes.
You know it. You barely tolerate it. But your grandparents will love it. It's the Macarena. Okay, this is the prototype C melody. It's a passable delivery, nothing of quality, nothing technically wrong. Damn, it is so catchy. I'm giving it the official Eiffel 65 mark of B-. There are right and wrong ways to have recurring chords throughout. I thought it was fine here. The chord progression didn't add anything, but it didn't get in the way. It was a dance craze, lightning in a bottle, if you will. The success is not unrelated to the rhythm of the song. The Bayside Boys did a very good job structuring the song. In fact, the ebbs, flows, and builds had as much to do with the success of the song as "Hey, Macarena." Interesting. I didn't come into this expecting to praise the timber. The Bayside Boys, though, did a real good job producing the song. Yeah, slutty lyrics. It's no stunning feat of poetry at any point.
Well, duh.
I took a cursory look at the 60 songs, just kind of eyeballing them. And I said the Macarena is going to be closest to five of the bunch. And the DJ Khaled line, if you will. Hey, I'm a prophet. 4.98 out of 10. Almost exactly DJ Khaled line of 5.0. Up next, the number one song from my birth year.
'69, the year I was born, universally regarded as one of the best and one of the most important years of all time for music. This is what I had to say about it.
1969, while Jimi Hendrix, Led Zeppelin, and David Bowie were changing the face of music and influencing generations of musicians, the pop charts were filled by no-talent hacks like Tommy Rowe and Bobby Sherman and the Cow Sills. The Archies had the number one song that year. The Archies.
I've got a soft spot in my heart for late 60s bubblegum cheese. Hell, the Association had my number two song of the 60s. But here, there's nothing remarkable about the melody or the singing, other than the backing female vocal feature at the end of the song, which raises a great tick. A three-chord song can work. Hell, a two-chord song can work, reference Uptown Funk. Even a one-chord song can work, reference Tomorrow Never Knows by the Beatles. This doesn't work. Just above mid-tempo, but not driving. Yeah, that's about right. So is the great, B minus. Nobody ever accused the Archies of being prog stalwarts. If you have evidence to the contrary, I invite you to provide citations in the comments below. Anyways, there were some semi-interesting developments in the outro chorus, including the Pour Some Sugar on Me. Moser would put in a Def Leppard reference here, but I threatened to feed him cat food tonight. There is a sweetness to the arrangement. The production is actually solid for such a lightweight song. This is why it's called Bubblegum.
1969 was the year I was born. It was a great year for music. But its representative on this list is a little lackluster. I give it 5.30 out of 10, a mediocre song. At number 47, the hardest rock song that we're going to cover on this list.
Well, thank you, 2002. I had forgotten Lifehouse existed. The band name sounds more like a middle school club that meets in Treehouse, or a fly-by-night megachurch. I honestly have no feelings about the band, or the song. This is a late 90s pop song played by a new metal band in 2001. It's a very unremarkable song, sung by a subpar post-grunge singer. Honestly, Jason Wade makes a lightweight song become a tough listen. There's really nothing to the chords, but it was a nice touch to start the bridge on the subdominant. The rhythm works in the song. There's a lot not to love on this musical exercise of the song, but the rhythm is actually pretty good. There's some energy here. Paint by numbers post-grunge form. The playing was better than Nickel Suck, but the production was about the same. According to lyricist Jason Wade, these lyrics are about his experience of frequently moving and as a kid not having any roots. Sure, why not?
Now there are worse songs on the list. There are more tedious songs. Even Bryan Adams' Dionne Warwick was a more interesting boring. But there's no song we're covering for this list that gave me less substance, ironically than the hardest rocking song. Go figure. Hanging by a Moment finished at 5.43 out of 10, high-end mediocrity. High-end mediocrity, I'm trademarking that one. Well, so that concludes the first set of songs we're reviewing from Billboard's year-end lists, 1963 to 1920 or 2022. So this covers from mediocre category on down. Went as low as brutal. Up next, we'll take a look at the decent and good categories, ranging from 5.5 out of 10 to 7.5. But before that, we'll hear from an old friend. Oh, I mentioned where I got it right after I announced what we were going to be doing.
Piggybacking on an idea from CHR83.
Settle down, Moser. If you like the video, be sure to mash the thumbs up below. If Moses all that in a bag of chips with anger management issues, be sure to subscribe. Tell me in the comments below how wrong I was in my reviews. Rest in peace, Tina Turner, and as always, rock on.
A little bit closer.